Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another video. And today is the day where I could finally show you a Ryzen build that I did that I wanted to do earlier, but I was not able to due to parts coming in late. But I finally was able to get all the parts together and build a Ryzen video. Now, I wanted to do this video earlier, but the motherboard that was ordered, the Asus Prime B350 Plus, was ordered on March 1st. But came on March 30th. Yeah, that's right. So it almost took almost a month for the motherboard to come through. Now I finally spent the last couple of days building the parts together and doing some benchmarks, but not as much as I like to due to time constraints. But I was finally able to build one, and I'm going to show you some benchmarks and talk a little bit about overclocking as well as some issues I had with the motherboard. So and I think this is probably the best CPU AMD has launched over the past decade, and certainly one of the biggest jump in performance. Now, I don't want to go into too technical details about this. You guys probably heard it, or you could do a research on it. But this is a processor. The Ryzen series processors is probably the biggest jump in performance in their history. And not only that, lowered the power consumption. And it was built from the ground up. AMD hired back Jim Keller. He was the one who originally worked on the Athlon processor. So he hired him back, and they built this processor from the ground up. It took them about over the last 4 or 5 years they've been working on this. And the performance was pretty amazing. The single threaded performance was over 50% in the end. And the top-end Ryzen 7 1800 processor could beat AMD's $1,000 processor for half the price, and almost 50 watt less than the Core i7 6900K. So it's a massive jump in performance, and I expect this processor to do well. So I'll try to give this, try to keep this video as short as possible. And I'm going to quickly jump to the benchmarks and tell you how it does, so you get a good idea of how this sub 1000 PC performs. So the specs I have for this video, the Ryzen 7 1700, the Asus B350 Plus AM4 motherboard. I use G-Skill RipJaws V-Series, 16 GB DDR4 RAM, and the XFX Radeon RX 480 XXX overclocked edition, as well as NZXT S340 Plus and a PNYC S1311, 240 GB SATA 3 SSD, as well as a EVGA 500 watt power supply. I'll be putting all the specs below the video, but this is the base, specs I use. Try to keep it less than $1,000. And so now let's go to the benchmarks. So on to the benchmarks. First off, we're going to start off with 3D Mark Vantage. It's about 8 or so years old, so but I still wanted to include that just to see how DirectX 10 performs on the Ryzen 1700. So got a score of 36,379 and a CPU score of 45,028, so which is an outstanding score. Next up, we're going to go on to the newer benchmark. So TimeSpy, we got a score of 3,944 and a CPU score of 7,009. And in CloudGate, we got a score of 34,265 and a physics score of 12,056. That, and what's interesting thing about this actually beats out my other Core i7 6700K rig, which had a physics score of 9,235 and an overall score of 29,774. So the extra 3,000 physics score due to the Ryzen 1700 lifted the CloudGate score of this new rig over my older Core i7 6700K rig, despite that other rig has a Fury X. So that just goes to show how great the Ryzen 1700 processor is. So the next score, next thing we're gonna look at is Skydiver. It has an overall score of 28,293, and that's actually less than my older rig with the Fury X, which has a 30,414 points. But if you look at the physics score, The Core i7 6700K is actually less than the Ryzen 1700. So that has a score of 11,903, and the 1700 has a score of 14,707. So again, that's almost around 3,000 or so points less. So that just goes to show how that again consistently shows how better the 1700 is over the 6700K. And in terms of synthetic benchmarks, the last one we have is the UniEngine Heaven Benchmark 4.0. An average score frames per second we got of 94.4, and that's actually higher than my other rig with the 6700K, which got a score of 66.8. So next we're going to talk about gaming benchmarks. Now I did not have time to do gaming benchmarks as I would have liked to, but I did was able to benchmark Doom as well as Titanfall 2. So Doom, we have everything maxed out in ultra quality with 4x TSA and 16x anisotropic filtering, and at 1080p we got 143 frames per second. At 1440p VSR we got 76 frames, and 4K VSR we got around 30 frames. So you could actually play 4K Doom on this with the Ryzen 1700. And with the Vulkan, I believe I got even higher frames, like maybe in the 40s and close to 50s in some cases. Next, another game I benched was Titanfall 2 with everything maxed out with the AO off and insane textures, which requires, I believe, 8 GB of VRAM. And at 1080p, we got 143 frames per second. So Ryzen 1700 is quite a performer when it comes to gaming. So I would highly recommend this over the 6700K as well as the newer Kaby Lake 7700K. Speaking of KB Lake, you may be wondering, how does the 7700K perform against the 6700K? Well, the difference is that it's hardly much difference between the 6700K and the 7700K. According to HardOCP's review of the 7700K IPC in applications like Cassandra 2016, the difference is often 0.013% or 0.129%. Applications like HyperPi is less than half a percent. In W Prime, it's around 0.1117%. And when you look at actual gaming benchmarks, the difference is also very negligible. Like in Lost Planet, is almost dead even. UniEngine benchmarks is less than 1%. In BioShock Infinite, it's like slightly over 1%. And in Metro Last Night, it's like 0.112%. So difference is very, very negligible. So Kaby Lake 4.5 gigahertz and Skylake 4.5 gigahertz, 6700K versus 7700K, they're practically dead even. So when you compare that to the Ryzen 1700, it's a much better overall processor. Now to further validate the performance of the 7700K versus the Ryzen 1700, we could look at other third-party benchmarks. For example, Joker Productions has benchmarks of the Ryzen 1700 at 3.9 gigahertz against a heavily overclocked 7700K at 5 gigahertz. And at 1080p, the performance are very similar. And it's almost neck and neck with the 7700K at 5 gigahertz. And that's assuming that you get 5 gigahertz on the 7700K, which is not always true. And as you can see at 1080p, it's pretty much even. And once you go over to 1440p, and you could see that the performance is even narrower, and it's starting to even win some of the benchmarks. So in the end, like I stated, you should not be getting a 6700K or a 7700K over the Ryzen 1700, and that's coming for someone who actually owns a 6700K. So I'm trying to be as neutral as possible. It's obvious that the Ryzen 1700 is the best price performance CPU that's out right now, and probably will be for the rest of the year. Now, quickly, I'll be going over to the review of the Asus Prime B3050 Plus motherboard and give you my review of it real quick. Overall, this is, I would say, it's an excellent board. It does have some of its quirks. Now, one thing I want to mention that it went through three different BIOS updates since its release. So I'm using the latest one that was released over a week or so ago. So maybe that's why I'm getting much better performance out of this motherboard and getting a much better performance compared to my older 6700K. So basically, this motherboard pretty much has everything you need, all the latest features, all the functionality for overclocking. It has your M2 data support. It supposedly can get up to 32 megahertz DDR4 RAM speed, and I'm going to talk about that later. It has all your excellent lighting, LED lighting, excellent audio, USB 3.0 as well as 3.1 support, and it has six gigabit port as well as 2x front USB 3.0 port, and it's solidly built. And overall, it's a very good looking, very solid motherboard. Now, the problems we had with this motherboard was that the DDR4 RAM stuck at 2133 megahertz. So we were not able to overclock that despite changing the DRAM voltage as well as the settings. And one unusual thing that happened is that we were able to overclock the CPU to 3.8 gigahertz by changing the clock multiplier on the BIOS settings. But after playing Doom and we started off Titanfall 2, this motherboard crashed, and the PC crashed, and so it might be related to instability, or it might be the fact that we used a 500 watt power supply, so you may want to try something like a 600 watt power supply. So the one issue was that the overclocking feature of the motherboard with respect to RAM, that was not quite good. So be aware of that, and maybe future updates or future BIOS updates will hopefully fix that. But one thing that's one thing you need to be aware of if you're going to buy that. But overall, it's a really good motherboard. So what's going to be my final score for the Ryzen 1700? I'm going to give it 9.5 out of 10 because it's an excellent processor. The pros are that it has excellent price to performance ratio. It matches or beats the Intel Core i7 6700K as well as the 7700K in synthetic and gaming benchmark. It has double the number of cores over the 6700K and the 7700K, and that's important in my opinion because the PS4 Pro as well as the Xbox Scorpio all uses 8 cores, and as more and more games uses 8 cores, I expect to see Ryzen performance increase and get better and better, and you'll see 6700K and 7700K, I'm assuming that it'll start to stagnate because they don't have 8 cores. And it has vastly improved IPC performance. And compared to previous generation Bulldozer and Piledriver, this is a vastly improved performance for AMD. So hats off to AMD. And not only that, this draws less power than the 6700K and the 7700K. And that's just icing on the cake. Now, one criticism I could have is that I would like an option to exclude the cooler. Despite the fact that the Wraith cooler is an excellent silent cooler, it looks pretty cool with the RGB lighting, I'd like to have an option to exclude that and save the extra, $30 or so and get a third-party cooler like Hyper 12 Evo. But that's, I think, a minor complaint. Overall, an excellent performer, an excellent processor, probably the best processor for 2017. So if you're in the market for buying a processor, don't even think about getting any other processor other than maybe if you don't want to do heavy workloads or something like that, get like 1800X, because that's half the performance, half the price of the 1600K, and it performs or matches that performance of the 6900K. So, and overall processor, and so I'm going to give it a final score of 9.5 out of 10. And for the Asus Prime B350 Plus, my score is going to be 9 out of 10. Its pros are that it has a premium quality motherboard that's less than $100. So it feels like a very high-end motherboard despite the fact that it costs less than $100. It has wider range of options for overclocking and tweaking. That's something you often find in higher end motherboards. So plenty of tools and options to tweak and play around with to increase your performance. It's very solid build quality and has great lighting. So it's pretty neat to see in the dark, to see all the red LED lighting. And it seems like a very well-cooled device and very solid. Now, the major con I have, and that's preventing me from giving this a higher score like 9.5, is due to the fact that the RAM speed is stuck at 2133 megahertz, despite the fact that I increased the voltage and played around the settings, and despite the fact that my RAM supports up to 2400 megahertz, I was not able to reach that. So it might be a BIOS issue, and hopefully future BIOS updates will fix that, because as I stated, it went through three different BIOS updates, and according to its specs, it should be able to reach up to 3200 megahertz. So it fell short of that, so I can't give it a higher score. But if you're looking for an ASUS motherboard that's a really nice, solid build, great looking, and it has a premium quality feel to it, I'll definitely check out the ASUS Prime B350 Plus. But feel free to check around with the other AM4 motherboards too. But ASUS one looks pretty decent, so I'm not gonna give it anything lower than 9. So check it out, but keep in mind that there are other motherboards you may not have this issue of memory stuck at 2133 megahertz. So that's gonna be my final conclusion for the B350 Plus motherboard. So it looks like after 10 years, AMD has finally caught up with Intel. Spent the last 4 or 5 years of building Ryzen from scratch, and it shows in the performance and value of this processor. So it's an exciting time to be following the CPU industry. But I hope you enjoyed the video, and don't forget Ryzen processor. Thanks for watching. My soul.